Hello and welcome, ladies, gentlemen, and non-binary, and happy National Superhero Day. I'm your host, Captain Amelia, and joining me today is our presenter, Mr. Electrique Mystique, also known by his alias as Eleazar Falco. Now, by day, Eleazar is an application engineer with Worth Electronic, but by night, he is a superhero in the electronics industry. Actually, he's that way all the time. Now, today, Eleazar will be presenting designing buck converters with multiple isolated outputs, of course, powered by our exclusive sponsor, DigiKey Electronics. If you have any questions during today's presentation, simply ask them in the questions box. But if we don't get to them today, or you think of a question later, always feel free to email us at hereforyou@we-online.com. or simply reply to the follow-up email. So if you join us late, maybe you have to leave early, or if you're not here at all together, just look for the presentation slides and the video on demand. We will send them to you after today's presentation within the next 24 to 48 hours. Simply look for them in your email. Register for our next webinars. We have two coming up next week on Tuesday the 4th. Join us for Connectors. It's our first connectors webinar. It's temperature rise and a derating of connectors. That's Tuesday the 4th. And then on the 6th, it's LAN on command. We're going to talk about the importance of LAN transformers in Ethernet devices. And now let's begin today's Worth Electronic webinar with Eleazar Falco, designing buck converters with multiple isolated outputs.
Thank you very much, Amelia, for the introduction. Hello, everyone, and welcome to this webinar, also from my side. So as Amelia mentioned, we are going to talk today about designing buck converters with isolated outputs. And the points of the agenda are the following. We will start with a short review of the basic operation of a synchronous buck converter. After this, we will show how to obtain one or more isolated outputs from this synchronous buck converter power stage, and we'll go through the circuit operation, the waveforms, etc. in detail. We will then do some analysis regarding the isolated output rail. Especially, we will learn about the parameters affecting the voltage regulation of the isolated outputs. And with this understanding, we will move on and go through some important design considerations and tips, which might help us improve the performance of the converter. Then we will introduce some of the Worth Electronic components, which are a good fit for this topology, as well as a couple of examples of available reference designs. And we will then close with the questions and answers section. So let's start with a quick review of the buck converter operation. The synchronous buck converter is built with two transistors, typically MOSFETs, in a half bridge configuration. Both transistors are represented here as control switches for simplification. The high side MOSFET connects to the input voltage rail, and the low side MOSFET connects to power ground. In normal operation, the MOSFETs switch alternately, which generates a square voltage waveform in the switch node, which is the node linking the two devices. To this node, a second order low pass LC filter is connected. What this stage does is filtering the fundamental frequency and the harmonics of the square waveform, leaving only the DC level at the output. The output voltage corresponds then to the average value of the square waveform in the switch node, and therefore it can be adjusted by changing the on time of the high side MOSFET, so its conduction time. This means the duty cycle of the PWM control signal to this device. But for this to work, it is important that the cutoff frequency of the output LC filter be set lower than the switching frequency. Here we can see the basic converter waveforms in continuous conduction mode operation, CCM. which means that the inductor still keeps energy stored before the end of each switching cycle. We can see how, when the high side MOSFET is turned on, the voltage appearing across the inductor is the difference between the input voltage and the output voltage. And the inductor current ramps up with a first order slope. When the high side MOSFET is turned off, the voltage across the inductor, as drawn here in the reference schematic, will equal the inverted output voltage. And the inductor current will decrease with a first order slope. The inductor current at the beginning and at the end of a full switching cycle in a steady state operation must be equal, as we can see here in the waveform. It is important not to confuse this output LC filter, which we mentioned in previous slide, with a standard EMI filter. The output inductor and capacitor are energy storage components in DC-DC converters, and for the buck converter, especially the inductor. Therefore, their values cannot be chosen arbitrarily. The output inductor must present high enough inductance in order to keep the ripple current to acceptable levels, typically 20 to 40% of the output current. On the other hand, the output capacitor must be big enough so that to reduce the output voltage ripple, as shown here in these two well-known formulas from the buck converter. What it is important to remember and to take from this slide is that during the off time of the control MOSFET, the well-regulated output voltage of the buck converter appears across the inductor. And this is important because this is going to be the reason why we can easily achieve additional output rails from a buck converter. So let's see now how we can achieve those additional isolated output voltage rails. By replacing the power inductor with a couple inductor or multi-winding transformer, we can achieve one or more isolated outputs as shown here in the image. We just need to add a rectifier diode and a capacitor to each output. With this, each isolated output voltage would track the non-isolated primary side output voltage of the buck power stage, scaled by the corresponding turns ratio, of course. Let's remember that the output voltage of the buck converter is the one which is directly well regulated. The isolated output voltage rails would therefore be indirectly regulated. We can say that way. But we will learn more about this, and we will see the operation of the circuit in more detail in the coming slides. But before we move on, let's make a small clarification. Should we call the magnetic component used in this topology now a couple inductor, a transformer, a two-winding power inductor? Looking at the construction and basic functionality of the component, we can see it has a primary winding and one or more secondary windings, one around a magnetic core with an air gap, which can be discrete or distributed. This means that it can store energy. Well, in this webinar, for simplicity, we will call this component a transformer, and we will see in the next slides that it actually works in both flyback mode and forward mode, but we'll see that later. Now, when it comes to usage in industry, typically this component is called differently depending on its role in the converter. For example, some people call it a couple inductor if the converter can also operate when the magnetic coupling between the windings is removed, like for example, in a CEPI converter. Conversely, it is referred as a flyback transformer if after removing the magnetic coupling, the converter no longer operates, like in the flyback converter. But as said, looks like this topic brings some discussion and debate amongst engineers. So it's not like the only truth here. We are trying to communicate only for clarification. Now, regarding the usage from magnetic component manufacturers, You can see normally classification in the catalogs as couple inductors or as a transformer separately. Here, typically, if the component is built using standard assemblies and techniques of power inductors like drum cores, molded cores, etc., then it is classified as a couple inductor. Now, these couple inductors normally are small in size with only two windings and 1-to-1 turns ratio. But this is not, this can be different in some cases also. So it's not the only truth. If the magnetic component is custom built using common transformer assemblies like EP, EE, or ER cores, it is then classified as a transformer. It is common for them to have different turns ratios and multiple windings. Although again, they can also have only two windings and a 1-to-1 turns ratio. Let's look now, go back at the operation of the buck converter with an isolated output in more detail. Here we analyze the time window during which the high side MOSFET is conducting, so the on time of the high side MOSFET, which is the control MOSFET. In this time, the energy is delivered from the input supply and input capacitor to the buck converter load, to the primary side output capacitor, and to the transformer. And like a buck converter, the output capacitor now stores net energy during the on time of the control MOSFET. This is an important difference with against the buck converter. Looking at the secondary side, the diode will be reverse biased and will be blocking a voltage equal to the input voltage of the converter scaled by the turns ratio. The current through the secondary winding will therefore be zero, and the secondary output capacitor will need to supply the energy to the isolated output load during this time window. Now, during the off time of the control MOSFET, the input supply is disconnected from the output stage, and it charges the input capacitor during this time window. The transformer now delivers the energy previously stored to both output loads, and this is done, we can say, in flyback mode. Energy has been stored during the on time in the magnetic core air gap, and it is being delivered now during the off time. Regarding the primary side output capacitor, it delivers now the energy to the secondary side output capacitor in forward mode. Instantaneous transfers of energy from the primary side to the secondary side without energy storage in the transformer core air gap. Looking at the secondary side, now during this time window, the diode is forward biased and the voltage reflected from the primary winding to the secondary winding equals the buck converter output voltage scaled by the turns ratio. As the diode is forward biased, this same voltage will appear at the isolated output. And this is how the isolated outputs, although they are not directly regulated, they can track the regulated output voltage of the buck converter stage scaled by the corresponding turns ratio as desired, of course. Also, during the off time, the isolated output capacitors now store the energy coming from the primary side output capacitor, and it will have to use this energy to supply the isolated load during the on time in the next switching cycle, as we saw in the previous slide. So let's see now some of the waveforms of the converter. Note that we have drawn now the transformer as an ideal transformer and an inductor representing the magnetizing inductance LM, which is the responsible for the energy storage in the transformer. And here are the main waveforms. First thing, we observe that the magnetizing current waveform, IM, is like in a standard buck converter. And we also appreciate that it is different than the primary winding current. Well, to be more correct, the primary winding current equals the magnetizing current, but only during the on time of the control MOSFET, which is when the secondary winding current is zero. During the off time, the primary winding current equals the magnetizing current plus the reflected secondary winding current. Let's not forget that during the off time, there is energy transfer from the primary side output capacitor to the secondary side output capacitor in forward mode. But it is very important to repeat that the reflected currents during the off time do not build any magnetic field in the core, as they compensate each other. Only the magnetizing current, and therefore the magnetizing current value at the end of the on time, which is the maximum, is the important parameter to consider for the saturation current rating of the transformer. And here we can see the formula used to calculate the magnetizing ripple current. Notice how it is the same than in a buck converter, but now we are talking about the magnetizing inductance of the transformer. The average value of the magnetizing current equals the primary output current plus the isolated output current squared by the terms ratio for one isolated output solution. Now, when we have multiple isolated outputs, then the output currents of each rail scaled by the corresponding terms ratio will have to also be taken into account for this calculation. And at the end, they will all add up to form the average magnetizing current. Regarding the minimum peak of the primary winding current, as well as the maximum peak of the secondary current, they actually depend on several parameters, like not only the output currents, but also parameters like the duty cycle, the switching frequency, or the leakage inductance. The best approach to find their value is via a SPI simulation. There are also some analytical approximations which can help to estimate roughly those values, but they are not so accurate like a SPI simulation. So let's see now some experimental results. But before, just for information, these experimental results that we are going to show in the next slides have been obtained with the board shown here. This is an experimentation board of a buck converter with one isolated output, which we use internally in Wurth Electronic. It allows to easily probe the important voltage nodes and measure the primary and secondary winding currents. Different couple inductors can be plugged in on separate PCBs, and it also allows to set the switching frequency between 200 kHz and 1 MHz, and also to adjust the output voltage as desired. It's good to know that this is not a reference design. This is a board which is only optimized for easy experimentation and changing the specifications easily. And we can see here the results for an input voltage of 24 volt and an output voltage of 5 volt, with primary and secondary outputs at light load, so 20 milliamps. We can observe how when the isolated output current is close to zero, the primary winding current is more or less the triangular shape magnetizing current. And here we can see the results now for an output voltage of 12 volts in primary and secondary outputs loaded both at 300 milliamps. We can observe clearly how during the on time of the control MOSFET, which you can see here, the primary winding current here equals the magnetizing current, but during the off time of the control MOSFET, now, as we have explained in next slide, there is now transformer action, there is forward mode, energy transfer, and there is reflected currents on the secondary side to the primary side also. And then we have this parabolic shape waveform. Let's do now some analysis about the isolated output rail, which as said is not directly regulated. Here we have the equivalent circuit of one of the secondary sides with some parasitics like the leakage inductance of the transformer reflected to the secondary side, as well as the winding resistance. We have also replaced the secondary winding by a voltage step source, and as we can see, we have an RLC resonant circuit. When the control MOSFET turns off, the voltage across the windings changes polarity very fast, and therefore a voltage step is applied to the RLC secondary side circuit. What is good to note here is that the wave shape of the secondary winding current is going to depend on several parameters, mainly the leakage inductance, the winding resistance, and the duration of the off time window, which is set by the duty cycle and the switching period. This makes it a bit complicated to find an accurate analytical expression for the secondary winding current. And here we have a SPI simulation with a typical specification which serves to illustrate the dependence of the secondary current wave shape upon the leakage inductance. We can observe that as the leakage inductance increases, we go from 100 nanohenry to 300 nanohenry to 600 nanohenry and 1.5 microhenry. Now the wave shape kind of moves from a parabola shape like to a more first order rising slope or triangular waveform. And we're going to see now some experimental results in how the current wave shape passes from a parabola to a triangular shape as the duty cycle, the switching frequency, and the isolated low current increase. Here we can see the starting specification with an input voltage of 24 volts and a duty cycle of 20%. The isolated output current is 100 milliamps and the switching frequency of 350 kilohertz. Since we will change the scale in the scope in order to be able to fit the waveform when we change these parameters, we are going to look at the value of the secondary current just at the end of the off time window as shown here, in order to put the amplitude of the secondary side current a bit in context. So what we do now, we increase the isolated output current to 200 milliamps. And now to 300 milliamps. And now we increase the duty cycle from 20% to 60%. And now we increase the switching frequency to nearly 1 MHz, so 950 kHz. Please note that the scale is being adjusted so that the waveform can fit in the screen as we mentioned before. Now we increase the duty cycle even more to 70%. And now we increase the isolated output load to 800 milliamps. And this resembles now a triangular waveform. We can look at the scale and notice the amplitude of around 1.8 amps. It is important to note that the secondary current wave shape during the off-time window can give us a clue of how good the isolated output voltage regulation is going to be. It will degrade as the secondary winding current passes from a parabolic shape to a triangular shape. But we will see this in the next slides in more detail. Now we have seen how the secondary side current shape changes with different parameters. Let's look now into the isolated output voltage regulation. In the case with ideal components, as we have seen, during the off time of the control MOSFET, the well-regulated output voltage of the buck converter appears across the primary winding and is reflected to the secondary winding scaled by the turns ratio. As the diode is forward biased, then this will also be the voltage at the isolated output, VOS. However, the components are not ideal, and the parasitics are going to play an important role in degrading the isolated output voltage regulation. Here we can see the equivalent circuit during the off time with parasitics. We have the RDS on of the low side MOSFET, the primary and secondary winding DCR, the leakage inductance of the transformer, and the nonlinear forward voltage of the diode. As current flows in the primary and secondary sides, the average voltage drops across these parasitic elements during the off-time window will determine the final output voltage, which we will obtain at the isolated output. But in order to quantify those average voltage drops, it is necessary to find first the average values of the primary and the secondary winding currents during the off-time window, which is the energy transfer window to the secondary side. For the primary winding, the average value is given by the expression shown here. Note that this value can be negative depending on the duty cycle and also on the ratio of the isolated output current and the buck converter output current. The primary winding average value during the off time helps determine then the voltage drops across the RD zone of the low side MOSFET and the primary winding DCR as shown here. Regarding the secondary winding current, the average value during this energy transfer window is given by this expression. It depends on the duty cycle and the isolated load current. And with this, we can estimate the voltage drops across the secondary winding DCR, and we can also approximate the diode forward voltage from its datasheet by taking the forward voltage value corresponding to the average secondary current value flowing through the diode. But we are missing one term. What about the voltage drop across the leakage inductance during the off time? Well, let's see next. If we approximate the secondary current by a first order rising slope, as shown here, the average voltage drop across the leakage inductance is going to depend on the secondary winding current amplitude and the off time window. We can approximate the secondary winding current amplitude as a function of the isolated output current, as shown here, but note that this is only an approximation which will help us to gain an intuitive understanding. With this, the average voltage drop across the leakage inductance would increase with the leakage inductance value, the isolated output current, the switching frequency, and the duty cycle. Again, this approximation will be accurate when the secondary winding waveform resembles a triangular waveform as shown here. But however, to our advantage, this is also the condition where the voltage drop across the leakage inductance will be maximum, as we will see in the next slide why this is the case. Here we can see again some experimental results for operating conditions at low duty cycle, low switching frequency, in a moderate output current. What we notice is how with such parabolic current shape, during part of the off-time window, the rate of change of current di by dt through the leakage inductance is positive, but it also becomes negative during other part of the off-time window. This helps achieve partial volt-second compensation already during the off-time. Let's remember that in steady-state operation and for a full switching cycle, there needs to be volt-second compensation across any inductance in the circuit, and also, therefore, across the leakage inductance. This means that the inductance needs to discharge or deliver all the stored energy each switching cycle. If there were full volt-second compensation already happening during the off time, the average voltage drop across the leakage inductance, which is affecting the output voltage regulation, would be zero. And conversely, the more volt-second compensation during the off time, the lower the voltage drop across the leakage inductance, and in turn, the less impact that the leakage inductance will have on the isolated output voltage regulation. Here now, we have experimental results for operating conditions at high duty cycle, high switching frequency, and high output current. Here we can observe how the di by dt is now positive during the entire off-time window, which will lead to a high voltage drop across the leakage inductance, degrading with it the output voltage regulation. As mentioned, there needs to be volt-second compensation in a full switching cycle. So the energy stored in the leakage inductance during the off-time needs to be somehow delivered or dissipated. In order to achieve this in this particular case, After the control MOSFET switches on again, we're gonna see here. After the control MOSFET switches on again, now the secondary winding current is gonna still conduct some current for a short period of time. And this is gonna be because the legacy inductance now will block the required voltage to keep the rectifier diode forward biased until it has delivered all the energy stored, and with it, it will achieve the volt second balance. Now, part of this energy is delivered to the load and the output capacitor on the isolated side, obviously, and part of it is dissipated as heat. So we can expect a drop in efficiency as the voltage drop across the leakage inductance increases. So in addition to the degradation of the output voltage regulation. And now we will see some experimental results regarding the isolated output regulation. But before again, we saw here the evaluation board used to obtain these results. It accepts an input voltage range from 10 to 32 volts and provides a regulated output voltage on the primary side, so the buck converter output of 5.3 volts. The switching frequency is set at 300 kilohertz, and in this case, also plug-in coupled inductor boards are used to easily change the magnetic component in the converter and check how they perform. And here we can see now the impact of the switching frequency in the isolated output voltage regulation. The duty cycle is set at 50%, and the primary output load current is 400 milliamps. We can see how for a higher switching frequency of 800 kilohertz, the isolated output voltage regulation slightly degrades with respect to a switching frequency of 300 kilohertz. And here now we can see the impact of the duty cycle. For a low duty cycle of 20% and a higher duty cycle of 50%. Clearly we can see, as expected, how the output voltage regulation worsens as the duty cycle increases. And here we can see now the impact of higher DCR and higher leakage inductance in the transformer on the isolated output voltage regulation. Well, to be more correct, in this case, we are using coupled inductors as per the catalog, comparing a big component like the MCRI with a smaller size TDC high voltage. As expected, a lower DCR and lower leakage inductance helps to achieve better regulation of the isolated output voltage. However, we should note here that the MCRI coupled inductor is bigger in size, quite bigger in size than the TDC high voltage, and with much lower isolation voltage rating. So it's not saying that one is better than the other one, it's just a comparison based on leakage inductance and DC winding resistance. We have seen that the voltage drops on the secondary side reduce the isolated output voltage in the previous experimental results. However, the voltage drops on the primary side might actually help to increase the isolated output voltage, depending on whether the average value of the primary winding current during the off time is positive or negative. And this again depends on how the output currents on the non-isolated output and on the isolated output compare, as well as depends on other parameters like the duty cycle or the leakage inductance. Here we can see an example with the isolated output at light load. And we can observe how increasing the buck converter output current, so the primary side output current, causes a higher reflected voltage to the secondary side, resulting in a higher isolated output voltage as a result as the primary side output current increases. This is caused by the voltage drops across the RDS zone of the low side MOSFET and the primary winding DCR. When having multiple isolated outputs, as the output current in one of these isolated rails increases, this is going to impact also the primary winding average current during the off time, and in turn, the voltage drops which set the final reflected voltage to each secondary winding. So there will be a cross-regulation effect depending on the load currents on each isolated output, and of course, on the buck converter output current. And here to remember well, we can see a conceptual diagram showing how as the leakage inductance, the switching frequency, the duty cycle, and load current are lower, then the voltage drop across the leakage inductance will be lower, and the isolated output regulation will be better. Let's see now a few important design considerations. There are applications which do not require tightly regulated supply voltages, like, for example, gate drivers or some communication interfaces using optocouplers, digital isolators, or specific communication transceivers. In many of these applications, then the voltage range provided by the isolated output of the buck converter will be in most cases good enough. However, some other applications require tightly regulated supply voltage rails. Examples of these are precision analog to digital or digital to analog converters, precision amplifiers, and the like those used in measurement equipment, for example, or some industrial PLC analog modules. In these cases, an additional output regulation stage must be added in order to meet this specification. For low output currents, a low dropout linear voltage regulator will be the most cost-effective solution. However, the efficiency will degrade, and you should also check the thermals. As the output current increases, this solution might become too inefficient, and it might even require, or it will require additional copper heatsink area on the PCB, so making the size of the solution bigger. In such case, a small DC-DC module, like for example the Magic VD-MM series, could be used as the output regulation stage. Since they are in fact integrated step-down switching regulators, the efficiency is much higher than with linear voltage regulators, and a small solution size can still be maintained at higher output currents of the application. When designing with LDOs in this topology, care should be taken to ensure that the worst case minimum voltage at the isolated output rail, which will be the lowest input voltage to the LDO, is still higher than the minimum low dropout voltage, which you can find this data in the datasheet, plus the LDO output voltage value. Similar considerations apply to when using a DC-DC micromodule. There is also another way to improve the voltage regulation of the isolated voltage rail, and it is by using a synchronous buck boost power stage topology instead of a synchronous buck topology, as shown here in the image. We should note that the output voltage of the buck boost topology is of inverted polarity with respect to the input voltage. And for that reason, it is typically not used in many of these applications where the isolated outputs are currently used. However, it is used the negative voltage in some specific applications also. The advantage of the buck boost converter is that for a set voltage conversion ratio, the duty cycle required will be lower than for a buck converter. And we can see this here in this graph. At low voltage gains, there is really no real advantage of using a buck boost converter versus a buck converter. However, as the voltage gain increases and approaches one, now you can see the difference on the operating duty cycle between the two topologies. So for example, for a 0.8 voltage gain, the buck boost converter will operate at around 45% duty cycle, whereas the buck converter will be already at 80%. And we can see that here in an LTSPICE simulation example, with a voltage gain of 0.7 in this case. The buck converter, under these conditions, will operate at 70% duty cycle, whereas the buck boost converter will operate at lower 40% duty cycle. And the improvement in the output voltage regulation is obvious. Here we can see the buck boost converter shows variation of around 6.5%, whereas the buck converter around 20%. Another important consideration is to use a synchronous buck converter instead of a non-synchronous converter. A synchronous converter uses a MOSFET for the low side switch, which can conduct current, as we know, in both directions. A non-synchronous converter uses a diode as the low side switch, and it can only conduct current in one direction. Now, using a diode can increase the light load efficiency as the converter enters discontinuous conduction mode operation. However, during the energy transfer window to the secondary side, the primary winding current might need to become negative, depending on the ratio of the isolated output current to the buck converter output current, as well as the duty cycle. However, this is not possible with a non-synchronous converter, and as a consequence, the energy delivered to the secondary side will be limited, which will cause the isolated output voltage to droop or even collapse as a result. For this reason, a synchronous converter should be used. However, it is important to watch out for specific operation modes, especially diode emulation mode at light load, which in fact will make the synchronous converter to operate like a non-synchronous type at light load. We don't want that. And here we can see a SPICE simulation showing the limitation of a non-synchronous converter. A load current step will be applied to the isolated output, increasing from 100 milliamps to 500 milliamps, while keeping the buck output current constant at 200 milliamps. We can see how the voltage droops considerably from around 4.6 volts down to 2.3 volts after the step current is applied. Zooming in, before the load current step, we can see that the converter was operating normally. You can see mainly because the current was positive. Primary current was above zero at all times. After increasing the isolated load current, more energy needs to be transferred to the secondary side in the off-time window, increasing with it the primary winding current amplitude. However, as the current cannot become negative now in the non-synchronous converter, not enough energy can be transferred to the secondary side, and as a consequence, the isolated output voltage droops, as we can see here. And here we can see another SPICE simulation. This time we keep the isolated output current constant at 500 milliamps, and the buck converter output current is stepped down from 500 milliamps down to 100 milliamps. Again, before the load step was applied, the converter was still operating normally because the primary current was positive at all times, thanks again to the high load current of the buck converter output or the primary side output. Now, when the primary side output current reduces, now the same behavior observed in previous slide can be observed. However, now the isolated output voltage has dramatically collapsed in this case, down to nearly 0.5 volt. So you want to use a non-synchronous converter, then you need to make sure that under all operating conditions, the primary winding current is always going to be positive. But if you use a synchronous converter, you don't need to worry about this. Let's talk now a bit about power limitation of this topology. So normally, IC controllers with integrated MOSFETs are typically used for the isolated output buck converter topology. This is in order to keep the solution size small and the topology competitive against other alternative topologies. This, however, has the limitation of lower heat dissipation capability and maximum peak current limit already preset in the controller for the internal MOSFETs. In the image, we can see the typical waveform of the transformer primary winding current. The positive current peak is limited by the control MOSFET current limit, so the high side MOSFET, and the negative peak by the low side MOSFET current sink limit. Here we can see an example from the datasheet of the LM5160 controller from Texas Instruments with the high side and the low side MOSFET devices current limits, which are integrated in the controller. We need to make sure that the minimum peak current limit of the high side MOSFET is still higher than the maximum primary winding peak current, which we can easily calculate as shown here in this formula. And similar is for the low side MOSFET. In this case, however, the negative peak needs to be found or should be found using SPI simulation for accuracy first and then confirm experimentally. As we can see, we have seen before that it depends on many parameters. Regarding the transformer, the saturation current rating needs to be above the maximum primary winding current, as again calculated with this expression here. It is also important to ensure that the transformer still has enough inductance at the maximum current limit value of the high side MOSFET integrated in the IC controller. Here on the right, we can see the converter operating at the onset of saturation. We can easily identify this from the primary winding waveform as shown here. Another important consideration is to verify the saturation of the transformer at the maximum operating temperature, as it has considerable dependence on temperature, the saturation characteristic, especially for ferrite cores. The rated current value given in the datasheet typically relates to a temperature rise of 40 degrees, but it is measured only with DC current. And this does not really account for the self-heating caused by AC-related power losses in the core and in the windings. Now, with the high RMS currents in this topology, it becomes very important to verify experimentally. Some PCB layout recommendations. Okay, let's define first a hot loop. So we refer to a hot loop to a circuit loop with very low inductance and containing switching devices like transistor or diodes. A very high DI by DT is generated during the switching transitions, which makes it important to minimize the loop area, amongst other considerations, in order to reduce the magnetic field radiation as well as inductive coupling to other circuits on the PCB. A hot node is a switching node with high rate of change of voltage, dB by dt. It is important to minimize the copper area and trace length of this node in the board in order to reduce the common mode noise as well as reducing parasitic capacitive coupling with other circuits on the PCB. Now, the buck converter has one hot node and one hot loop. However, the buck converter with isolated output has actually three hot loops. And this is because during the off time of the control MOSFET, when transformer action is taking place as the primary side output capacitor transfers the energy in forward mode through the transformer to the isolated output capacitor. Now, the reflected primary and secondary currents do not see the magnetizing inductance. The only break for the rate of change of current, dI by dt, is the leakage inductance. However, as we saw before, the leakage inductance is typically minimized in order to improve the regulation. So there is little to slow down the DI by DT in these two current loops now. So they should be also keep the area as small as possible. Let's see now some Wurth electronic component series for this topology, as well as a couple of reference design examples. Here we have some of the copper inductor series, which are a good fit for this topology. The DPC high voltage comes in a very compact form factor of 5 by 5 millimeters and 3 millimeter height, and features isolation to 1.5 kilovolt and 1-to-1 turns ratio. The TDC high voltage is a bit bigger and comes in two height variants, one low profile of only 1.8 millimeters and other of 3.8 millimeters, with isolation voltage of 2 kilovolt and 1-to-1 turns ratio. The MTCI has the same assembly and form factor than the DPC high voltage, but lower isolation voltage of 100 volt. However, it offers different turns ratios, in this case 1 to 1.5 also 1-2 and 1-3. And then I show here also the MCRI, although this is more a couple inductor for a CV converter, but can also be used in the isolated output back converter, especially for higher output powers. It's a bit bigger in size and has lower isolation voltage of 200 volts. As mentioned, it is a good fit for higher power applications in this case. We can observe how the DPC-HV, the TTC-HV, and MTCI, they are built using a shielded drum core assembly, and the MCRI is an iron powder molded core couple inductor. Regarding transformers, there are many of them which were designed for specific reference designs of semiconductor companies. We have, for example, the MID-IBTI, with many reference designs available with Texas Instruments controllers. They feature up to 4 output windings, many different tens ratios for typical isolated output voltages, input voltage range up to 100 volt, and isolation voltage from 650 volt up to 6 kilowatt. But this parameter depends on which transformer we are selecting, obviously. Also, the MID-IB Max with reference design with Maxim integrated controllers. They feature up to 4 output windings and up to 42 volt input voltage, as well as 3 kV isolation. And then we have also the MID-IBTEL, which were designed for telecom applications. They feature one isolated output with a 1-to-1 turns ratio, 2.25 kilovolt isolation, and the typical input voltage range for telecom of 36 volts to 72 volts. And here you can see an example reference design with the LM5160 synchronous buck controller from Texas Instruments, the TIDA00199, which implements a gate drive system for driving IGBTs in three-phase inverter applications. The auxiliary supply of the gate drive of the gate driver system is implemented with the isolated buck converter topology in this reference design. This topology is also trademarked as a flight buck converter by Texas Instruments. It provides up to 2.3 watts of power per output, and the MID-IBTI transformer used here features basic insulation for a working voltage of 400 volts RMS, as well as 4.5 kilovolt isolation. For more details about the design, you can access directly via this link shown here. And here we have another reference design example using a controller from Maxim Integrated. In this case, the MAX17681. It accepts an input voltage range up to 42 volt and provides bipolar outputs of plus minus 15 volt or plus minus 12 volts with a total output power of up to 5 watts. Also to mention that this topology is trademarked as an ISO-BUCK by Maxim Integrated. And the IB Max transformer used here features 1.5 kV isolation. But you can also search for reference designs from semiconductor companies which are using Wurth Electronic components directly on Wurth Electronic website. And here a link is provided. As an example, shown here, use filtering for reference designs from Texas Instruments for the flyback topology. In Wurth Electronic, we are currently working on new reference designs with couple inductors at the moment. And also a new application note about this topic, designing buck converters with isolated outputs, will be released soon. And this application note, which also will also include a step-by-step design example. So thank you very much for your attention. If you have any questions, please type them in, and I will do my best to try to answer to some of them. So let's have a look. Okay, we have a question. Start with this one. How many outputs are possible? Well, we can say as many as you want, as long as the transformer can handle it, the combined power of all the isolated outputs, and also taking into account the current limit of the integrated MOSFETs of the controller, which is used. These are basically the two, I would say, the two main parameters limiting the output power in this topology. You can use external MOSFETs. Also, you can use a different controller as well to increase the output power capability. Now, number of outputs, you can use, we can see reference design with four outputs easily. But that is because the typical applications, they require that. But if you want to use six or eight outputs, it should be also be possible. Okay, I hope I answered that question. Let's move on. More questions. I have many questions here. Okay, another question. When is better to use a transformer and when a couple inductor? Well, that is a good question. Power inductors are normally smaller in size and therefore they are better fit for lowest power applications. I would say up to 2 to 3 watts for the most common specifications found, for example, I'm thinking right now in industrial applications, they typically require stepping down from 24 volt bus down to 12 volts, 5 volts, or 3.3 volts. So in this kind of applications, up to 2 to 3 watts, you might be able to use copper inductors like the best fit. Normally, they are used for industrial communication interfaces in these cases. Now, about 3 watts of power, I would say in these applications, a transformer is normally used. Also, in addition to this, if you need to meet basic or reinforced insulation in the isolated supply, then clearly a transformer must be used in this case. Couple inductors, they only offer normally what is off the shelf available in the market right now, typically functional insulation only. Then we have also seen that when multiple isolated outputs are required, also a transformer will be used in this case. But again, I'm talking here about, in thinking about the typical industrial applications, as mentioned, and I hope I could answer that question. Okay, let's look for more questions. What, another question, what efficiency could be expected? It's a good question also. Here, it depends. That's the answer. It depends. It depends which is the application. It is a gate drive application. It is a how much is the output power, or it is a communication interface, isolated communication interface application. It's going to depend, but we can see a range of efficiency which can go from, I would say, 78% up to above, I would say, nearly or above 90%. But it will depend on what is the end application and the specification. How much you are stepping down the voltage, what duty cycle you are using, which are you using a back power stage or a back boost power stage. There are many things that have an impact on the efficiency. And also in many cases, you want a good efficiency, obviously, mainly for thermal performance. But if you want to optimize for a small size, then you're gonna need to sacrifice a bit the efficiency for that. So it depends. If you really want to optimize the efficiency to the maximum, you're not gonna end up with such a small solution. I would say, I'm confident you can go even over 90% slightly with this topology, depending on the specifications as mentioned. Another question. What is the maximum duty cycle recommended for good regulation? Right, that is also a good question. Right, so there are some rules of thumb that you can find for the maximum duty cycle. Some application notes, you can find they recommend to keep it under 50%. Obviously, the lower the duty cycle, the better. We have seen in the slides the strong impact of a high duty cycle in the output regulation. But I would not limit it to 50%. I would say the best approach is to run a SPI simulation for your specification that you want to use. And with a SPI simulation, you can very quick, very fast and inaccurate see how good the output voltage regulation is going to be. Of course, you need to a good simulation model for that. You need to put the leakage inductance there and all the parasitics also there. But you can check it already in SPI simulation. So it is not about dismissing this topology if you need a duty cycle which is higher than 50%. It's how much output power you have also, because the regulation is going to degrade quite a lot as the isolated output current increases. Now, if you need very low power, let's say half a watt or 1 watt, then you might be able to operate at higher duty cycle than 50%, even though if you need a tightly regulated output, so you are not happy with that regulation, then you can change the tens ratio of the transformer or use a copper inductor with a different tens ratio also and step up the isolated output voltage a bit and now add an LDO. An LDO will be a good fit for a very low power application. And then you have a very well regulated output voltage, isolated, very low power, right? But you can use the topology. You might be operating at a higher duty cycle than 50%. So the best answer I believe here is to check in SPI simulation what the output voltage regulation is going to be really. Good. So we are going to leave it here. All the questions, for any questions that were not answered here, you can send them to us by email, and we will reply to them by email, those questions. Now from my side, I really thank you for attending this webinar. I really hope that it was useful for you. And from my side, I will hand over now to my colleague Amelia, and I wish you a great day.
All right. Thank you, Elazar, for presenting, and thank you for joining us for today's webinar. Now, as a reminder, as Elazar mentioned, if you have any questions or you think of them later, simply reply to our follow-up email or email us directly at hereforyou@we-online.com. That's here, the number 4YOU at we-online.com. Register for our next two webinars coming up next week. On the 4th, it's temperature rise and derating of connectors. And on the 6th, LAN on command. If you want to stay up to date on our webinars, you can always follow me on LinkedIn. My name is Amelia Thompson. You can also follow our corporate pages. We're on Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, TikTok, everywhere you think you want to be. That's where you're going to find us. Thanks again for joining us. We'll see you soon.